Luke chapter 19, verses 41 to 48. The sermon didn't start here for me tonight. It started in the Gospel of John, and I'll explain that as we get into the sermon a little bit. But following Luke's narrative from this morning on Palm Sunday, we see there's some other events that took place during that day as well. Luke chapter 19, verses 41 to 48. And when you find your place there, let's stand for the reading of the Word of God. And let's read these verses responsibly, beginning in verse 41. Join me in verse 42, and we'll follow that pattern out of verse 48. The Bible says, when he was come near, he beheld the city and wept over it, saying, if thou hadst known, even thou, at least in thy day, this thy day, the things which belong unto thy peace, but now they are hid from thine eyes. For the day shall come upon thee, that thine enemies shall cast a trench about thee, and compass thee round, and keep thee in on every side, and shall lay thee even with the ground, and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. And he went into the temple and began to cast out them that sold therein and them that bought, saying unto them, it is written, my house is the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. And he taught daily in the temple, but the chief priests and scribes and the chief of the people sought to destroy him and could not find what they might do, for all the people were very attentive to hear him. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your love. And thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you for the Word of God that teaches us great things about you, your plans, and Lord, just so much more. We thank you, Lord, for the faith that it has birthed in us. And we thank you, Lord, for the faith that, Lord, has saved us. And Lord, we thank you for letting us know all about your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and what he's done for us. We ask that tonight, Father, you give us ears to hear. I pray that, Lord, we'd have soft and tender hearts, Lord, that your word and the seed of your word might find good ground to be sown into tonight. I pray that, Father, we would be more interested than just hearing the word of God, but, Lord, we would be seeking for active ways to begin acting upon it and to be doers of your word as well. We love you. We thank you, Lord, for this time. Praying again, as Brother Dave prayed, that if there's anybody among us that does not know Jesus as his or her Savior, that tonight would be that night of salvation for them. And for those who do know the Lord Jesus Christ, we might be drawn closer to his precious side as we consider these events in his life. We love you and give you all the praise and honor and glory for what you're about to accomplish in our midst. For it's in Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen. And you may be seated. In this narrative that Luke gives us of Palm Sunday, it does not stop with Jesus Christ making his entry into Jerusalem. It continues on. And the first thing we see that Luke mentions after the triumphal entry, it tells us, and Luke tells us, that Jesus Christ, when he became near, the Bible says he beheld the city and wept over it. And I think it's very interesting that after this triumphal entry, that Jesus Christ and his sympathy are something that Paul that is addressed here as Luke makes note of this. And when he came near, he beheld the city and wept over it. The sympathy of the Savior takes center stage, not just his praise and adoration from the ride into Jerusalem, but him taking time to look over that city. And I want to say, if there's one thing that we as Christians ought to be engaged in, I mentioned it this morning and taught on it this morning in our Sunday school class, is our prayer life. But I really think our prayer lives are not as active, not as passionate, not as vibrant as they could be, because we are not as sensitive as we should be. We're not taking in all that's around us. God's put us in the midst of folks that are on their way to an eternity separated from God, and it ought to move us. And Jesus Christ, when he looked out at Jerusalem, he saw a city that by and large had either ignored him or rejected him, and he wept over that city. The sympathy of the Savior came to the forefront. And let me just say this, if the Savior could weep over his city and his capital city, should not we too also have tears for the lost in our city? There ought to be a burden. There ought to be a breaking of heart. There ought to be a compassion in us that would cause us to run to our Father and shed tears for the sins of our people. You know, I read the newspapers, and I know Jeanette does not have a very good reputation. It doesn't. I mean, but I'll tell you what, should not then we be in the right, or not then we in the right place to address the needs of our city? Should not our tears be part and parcel of the solution for Jeanette's problems? I think sometimes we just, well, that's Jeanette, and that's always been Jeanette. And then, no, my friends, if God put us here, and he did, and God's kept us here, and he has, then certainly he expects us to have a compassion upon those whom we've been set here to minister to and to proclaim the gospel to.
So Jesus Christ, as he takes a look over that city, begins to consider that city and all that are in that city. And let me just say this, with a compassion that was foreign to Jonah, Jesus Christ begins to weep over Jerusalem. He begins to consider their plight. And so we see the sympathy of the Savior. And I want to say this, the sympathy of the Savior ought to be matched by his followers, by his disciples. There ought to be a broken heart. There ought to be a tenderness of heart when we consider the needs of the lost around us, the needs of the unsaved around us, the plight and the eternal damnation of those that are lost around us. There ought to be some consideration of those souls. It ought to burden us. It ought to break us down sometimes. It ought to weigh heavy on us as we consider where they're at and what they're facing without the Savior. And it ought to start a desire and spark a desire in us to want to tell them about the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see the sympathy of the Savior in verses 41 and 42. In verse 42, he says this, saying, "If thou hadst known, even thou, at least in this thy day, the things which belong unto thy peace, but now they are hid from thine eyes." How many times have we come back from soul winning and just burdened? Why? Because nobody had time, nobody had an interest, nobody had a desire to hear about the Savior. And it's a breaking of heart. There's no great rejoicing in just going out. But the Bible does tell us when we go out weeping, bearing precious seed, we shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing our sheaves with us. How many times have we gone out soul winning with no tears in our eyes, no burden in our heart, no heartache for the lost, and we come back empty? Why? Because there have been no tears accompanying the journey. There have been no tears accompanying the sowing. And so, my friends, if we do need to be a people of prayer, and we do, we also need to be people of tears as well and weeping over the right things. I remember reading this story this week, and I don't know why I read it. It was just a story about this dog who died, and it kind of touched my heart. And I'm really not real fond of my dogs, but, you know, I could see how somebody might be fond of their dog. I'm jealous. Yes, I'm jealous of all the attention that dog gets. Yes, I am. Be still my heart. But it hit one of those heartstrings where, man, that's kind of sad, you know. And I felt my eyes getting a little teary there. And it was just over a stupid dog that I'm sitting here thinking, how could I cry? And again, I understand the attachment that people have to their pets. I understand that. I really do. I'm not knocking anybody. But how can I get teary-eyed about a pet when there are people in every direction? I mean, blocks. I mean, not even blocks from the church that are dying and going to hell. When's the last time I cried over them? Oh, my friends, if the indictment upon us is we're not the people of prayer we ought to be, then I would also say we're not the people of tears we ought to be. There ought to be a burden in our heart. There ought to be a tenderness of heart. There ought to be tears in our eyes as we consider the lost. Can I ask, when was the last time you wept over the lost condition of a loved one? The lost condition of a family member? The lost condition of an acquaintance? A co-worker? Jesus Christ wept over a whole city. We ought to be just as tender and just as sympathetic and just as our Savior is. We're called Christians. That means Christ-like. Is that right? Then that sympathy ought to be part and parcel of who we are. Not only do we see the sympathy of the Savior, we also see the shock that he spoke of regarding the future times. He told of Jerusalem's coming destruction. And guess what? It was fulfilled to the T. In AD 70, Roman General Titus came in. The Romans had enough of the insurrection of the Jews. And the Roman General Titus came in and laid the city flat. The temple, there were no two stones upon each other. When Dr. Hiltabit was here, he was telling me about one of the discoveries that their teams made over there, how they made the discovery of the tube coming off the altar that took away the blood and things like that, and how they found that, and how that was blocked by a block. And when they opened up that tube, he said that they found skeletons in there that had been trapped inside that city. Jesus Christ said, "The day shall come that thine enemy shall cast a trench about thee, encompass thee round, and keep thee in on every side, and lay thee even with the ground." When they found that tube leading off the altar from the temple, and they found those bodies in there, they were trapped in. They could not get out. They were surrounded in there, and the Romans came in and burned the city down and knocked the city down. What he said, and I don't know if you were here to hear this, but he said that block that they used to block up that passageway was actually a block from the temple that they had taken off the Temple Mount and put there to block that in. My friend, Jesus Christ knew exactly what was going to happen, and he began to weep over that city and began to reveal some of the shock of the future times. I think sometimes we really don't think anything's going to change. We think things are just going to continue day after day. That's what Jesus Christ said would be a sign of the times before his coming. Just like the days were in the days of Noah, there should be eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. Everybody thinks it's just going to continue on with no great change. And Beck and I were on our way in this morning, and she said, well, it just seems like everything has changed. And it has. I mean, whatever direction you look, it just nothing's the same. The world that I grew up in is no longer exists. of the world that I grew up in. I could go out and leave my house in the morning at 7:30, 8 o'clock in the morning. That's different, amen. And just go out and play all day, and my mother would not worry about us. I mean, we could get on our bicycle and ride all over Fort Island. We could ride into Greensburg, and as long as you're home in time for dinner, guess what? There was not a word said. I don't like my daughter or my son being out of my, I'd like to know where they're at all the time. I mean, that's how different our world is, and we can take that and run that a million different directions, but our world has changed, and I want to say this, not for the better. But these folks in Jerusalem just thought, well, everything was just going to continue on. And Jesus Christ said, I've got some news for you. It's not going to be very pleasant in a few years. In just a couple decades, everything's going to get obliterated here. There's not going to be anything normal left. And I want to say this, my friends. I don't know what's on the morrow. I do know who is on the morrow. But I don't know what's on the morrow. So you know what? I ought to approach each day as it is, as a gift from God, and just thank God for the goodness of that day, and just keep trusting Him, and just ask Him to meet the day with me. The Bible tells us real clearly in Proverbs 27:1, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. We don't have any idea what's on the morrow. Jesus Christ was letting them know the shock that was coming up to them, and the destruction of the temple and the destruction of that city and the weeping and the loss that would be experienced by them because they missed their day of visitation. They turned away from the Son of God who was given to them. And how many signs do we miss? How many signs of God's goodness and God's mercy and God's grace do we miss on a daily basis that could prepare us for those tough days ahead? I'm not any great preacher. I'm not claiming to be, and I don't even know what that means to be a great preacher. But I know I'm not one. Let me just say this: I'm smart enough to figure out I might not need the sermon today, but I probably will need it somewhere down the line. If it's not something that applies to me right today, it will apply to me somewhere. I've got to understand that when God puts a truth out there, or I find something in my own studies or in my own devotional times, I find those things, I write them down, I store them away because I'm probably going to need them somewhere in the future. These folks missed the day of their visitation. They missed the great gift of God. They missed the Son of God put in their midst for this specific purpose. It could have prepared them for the days ahead. And we need to be laying up in store for ourselves faith and truth and principles from the Word of God that will help us to face those tough times ahead, help us to face those unexpected turns in the course ahead. And so he was revealing the shock of the future times to them. In James, the Bible says the same along the same lines. Go to you now, ye that say today or tomorrow we will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. He says, whereas you know you're not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. For ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. And so we get complacent sometimes and just figure things are going to continue, but we ought not to have that kind of attitude. Our attitude ought to be every day is a special gift from God. If you're like me, sometimes I'm guilty of looking ahead on the calendar. Can't wait for this to get here. And then I miss the blessing of today. You know, I'm guilty of this, especially around Christmas time when November gets up here, my thoughts jump ahead to the 25th. Love Christmas. I just enjoy that. And sometimes I miss the blessings of the days leading up to that. We can't afford to do that. We must enjoy and appreciate each day as a gift that it is. The folks in Jerusalem did not do that. So Jesus Christ spoke of the shock of the future times and the missing of the present blessings. Now, after Jesus Christ gave that instruction there, the Bible says he went into the temple in verse number 45. As he went into the temple, he began to cast out them that sold therein and them that bought, saying, it is written, my house is a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves. We see the scourging and the cleansing of the temple. Now, this is interesting for those folks that look at Jesus Christ as some long-haired hippie pacifist. He was not. He went in there like a man, and he said, this is not the way it's going to be. He went in there and scourged and cleansed that temple. I'll give you some of the other renderings from the other Gospels about this. Matthew describes the entering and the scourging and cleansing in the temple this way. In Matthew 21:12, and Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. That overthrowing was not a very pleasant thing. Please get off your seat, sir. Would you kindly step to the side? No, overthrowing, man, he ripped him off the chair. I mean, sometimes one of the dogs would be sitting at my chair at the table at the dinner. I'm not usually really kind. I kind of, you know, jerk the chair up and tip him off. Oh, Pastor, you're so mean. It's not his chair. It's mine. Amen? get out the road. Well, Jesus Christ went in there, and the Bible says when he overthrew the tables and the chairs, I mean, it was not a very pleasant, it was not a very timid action on Jesus Christ's part. It was very very definitive and demonstrative as he went in there and just threw things over and overthrew the tables and the seats of them that sold doves. And he said unto them, it is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer, but ye've made it a den of thieves. Mark, in his account of this, said this in Mark 11:15, and they come to Jerusalem, and Jesus went into the temple and began to cast out them that sold and bought in the temple, and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves, and would not suffer that any man should carry any vessel through the temple. And he taught, saying unto them, is it not written, my house shall be called of all nations a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves. Jesus Christ was wound up. He was angry. He was frustrated. The Bible says not only he overthrew the tables and the chairs, but he didn't let anybody go through there carrying vessels. He said, this is not proper for this place. This is not proper for this day. He said, this house, my Father's house, is supposed to be known as a house of prayer, someplace special. It's not to be known as a den of thieves. It's not for the merchandising of everything that's going on here. He said, there's a problem, and he corrected that problem very, very powerfully. John puts it this way in John chapter 2, verse 13, and the Jews' Passover was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and the changers of money sitting. And when he had made a scourge of small cords, he drove them all out of the temple and the sheep and the oxen and poured out the changers' money and overthrew the tables and said unto them that sold doves, take these things hence and make not my Father's house a house of merchandise. And his disciples remembered that it was written, the zeal of thine house hath eaten me up. Oh, well, would God there was a zeal for God's house again, and a zeal for the things of God again, and a passion for the things wherewith we deal with God. There ought to be an attachment to the things of God again. Would to God there was a zeal for the book again. A passion, a prominence in the life of the children of God to read the word of God again, and not only to read it, but to apply it. But to put it into practice. Would to God there is a zeal for the church house again, amen? Where we'd stop making excuses why we can't be here. I've got the sniffles. Kitty's got a hairball. I've got a hangnail. I mean, all the excuses, take them, put them in a bag, and dump them into the sea. Well, I guess that would be against the ecological balance there. Well, put it in a garbage can or put it in a landfill somewhere. But, I mean, we need to take the excuses away why we can't be here, why we should be here. See, you're saying that because you're pastor. I'm saying that because there ought to be a zeal for the things of God. The church is a special place. It ought to be a special place. It ought to be regarded as such and not discounted and not disregarded by the people of God. The church house ought to be just as full Sunday night as it is Sunday morning. It ought to be just as full Wednesday night as it is on Sunday. I know some folks are providentially hindered, and I know there's some folks that are medically hindered from being here. I understand that. But I'll tell you what, we better check our excuses and see if God's buying. We can make every excuse under the sun why we can't be here. Why? Is it not important? Are not the things of God eternal? Is not the Spirit of God present among us when we gather together in the name of Jesus Christ? Has he lost his power? Has the church house lost its place of prominence in the life of the Christian? I would submit to you and no. I know there are plenty of critics out there that say, well, we're past the church age, but the Bible, they need to catch up with the Bible then, because we're not. We're still in the church age. And I know there have been preachers on the TV and preachers on the radio that say, you know, there's no good churches left. I would agree there are no perfect churches, and certainly ours is not perfect. But I'll tell you what, as long as it's founded on the Bible and following the Lord Jesus Christ, we owe an allegiance to it. I'm not saying to a man, but I am saying that to the ministry and to the program of the church, there ought to be a loyalty and an allegiance and a fidelity. Jesus Christ was wound up. Why? Because they had changed the purpose of the place. They used it as a place to sell at profit. Let me just say this. They needed the animals in their sacrifice. They did. But these men were coming in and selling things at a profit. They're making money on that. The money changers, they're taking and making a profit on changing that money into the currency of the temple. We understand that, right? And so they were making merchandise. They were making a profit off the people of God. And let me just say this. That's wrong. Church is not a profit center. We're not here to make money. Although some people that call in every day for, you know, their rent to be paid, they think we're a bank of some sort. I don't understand that either. But again, if we get away from the purpose of this place, we're lost. Jesus Christ said this is going to change. He cleansed that temple, and I think it's very fascinating. I want to draw another parallel to another portion of Scripture. So Jesus Christ cleansed out that temple, and he had some words to say about the cleansing of a temple. In Luke 11:24, Jesus said this, "When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through the dry places, seeking rest, and finding none. He saith, I will return to my house whence I came out. And when he cometh, he findeth it swept and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh unto him seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there, and the last day of that man is worse than the first." See, Jesus Christ cleansed out that temple, but as soon as Jesus Christ was gone, the temple reverted back to the wickedness, and it became as deficient and derelict as it was before Jesus Christ came in there. And there's a parallel to the human temple. When we get this body clean, there's a reason to keep it clean, amen? And there's a reason to have it filled up with the Holy Spirit of God so that uncleanness does not return in greater strength. And so the cleansing was very important, but you know what? They didn't continue with that cleansing. They didn't continue to labor on and to keep it clean once it had been cleaned up. So too it is with us. When we repent and when we seek God's forgiveness and we seek God's face and when we look for that cleansing and that healing and we receive it from God as we confess our sins to Him and He forgives us and cleanses us from all unrighteousness, we got to do our best with the Holy Spirit's help to stay clean, not revert back to that sin which we just confessed. So we see the scourging and the cleansing of the temple there. But lastly, when we come to the end of our passage, we also see the suitable use for the temple. It wasn't to make merchandise. It wasn't to make a profit. But it was to teach the people of God. What's the purpose of this place? It's the same. It's a place to teach people. It's a place to, I'm going to say this. I feel sorry for folks that go without church. I really do. Because they're missing the fellowship of the saints. They're missing the camaraderie. They're missing the closeness. They're missing the intimacy among believers that our spirits need. I was talking to a gentleman recently, and I hadn't seen him in a little while, and I stopped and paid him a visit and just said, you know what? I miss most of all. I said, I miss giving you that man hug at the end of the services. I do. I said, I appreciate that. I guess I'm a hugger. I guess that's what I am. Amen. But some folks aren't huggers. That's okay. I don't hug people that aren't huggers. But I miss that. You know, that's just something that's that closeness here. And you know, I've heard other preachers say, well, you know, you shouldn't be doing that, hugging and stuff like that. Well, I always look to the Bible and say, you know, the Bible tells us to greet one another with a holy kiss. No, we're not going to get it. We're not going to be the kissing church. Not going to happen. Not going to happen. But let me just say that there ought to be a friendship. A closeness here. I'm not kissing Brother Roger. I love Brother Roger. I'm not kissing you, Brother Roger. Sorry. But pucker up, buttercup. Amen. Not going to happen. But you know what? There ought to be a camaraderie. There ought to be a closeness that's shared and expressed. Amen. This place is special. Why? Because the people of God come here. The Spirit of God meets with us here. The praises of God are sung here. The worship of God is enjoined here. The Word of God is taught and preached and believed on here. It ought to be a special place. And if it's not, that needs to be corrected in our hearts and in our minds. Jesus Christ corrected it, and then Jesus Christ not only corrected it, but He showed what it should have been used for. And the Bible says that Jesus Christ taught daily in the temple. That was the purpose of the temple. The purpose of the temple was a place of prayer. Amen? So people were to go there to pray, to commune with God. The people also went there to be taught so they could commune one with another while they commune with God and be taught of God. These are important things. The church has a very important part to play. I'm preaching to the choir tonight. I know the choir's here, but I'm also preaching to you who are here. So the empty seats can't help us, but the folks that should be filling those empty seats need to hear that there's a special part that the church ought to be playing in their lives. And if it's not, then the problem there's a problem that needs to be corrected there. So Jesus Christ showed the suitable use of the temple, the daily teaching, but not only the daily teaching, the attentive listening. You could have a Charles Haddon Spurgeon standing in front of you and expounding upon the Word of God as the Prince of Preachers could do, but if there's nobody out there to hear or people out there that are dull in their hearing, then it's really not going to do any good. The effective communication of the gospel takes a sound message, but it also takes open ears. It also takes tender, prepared hearts. I think one of the things we forget is, have we prepared to come to church? I'm not talking about how we put on our church clothes, but how we put on our church ears. In our church hearts, and our church minds. Have we come prepared to receive the gospel? Have we come prepared to receive from the God's word those things that we need? I dare say that many of us came in tonight with burdens and things that would distract us from hearing the message tonight. Whether that's work, whether that's home, whether that's relatives, whether that's economics, whether that's uncertainty about the future. We sometimes let these things cloud our minds and burden us before we come in the doors. Can't we see how that interrupts the transmission? One of the things I'm always praying for and begging God for before I preach, Lord, just clear my mind. I don't want to be distracted. I've got enough problems chasing rabbits as it is, amen. I want to be as clear in mind as I can when I'm preaching, so I'm not disruptive to you hearing what the word, what the Spirit would like to teach you tonight. So Jesus Christ was in there teaching. They had the master teacher there, but he also had an audience that was willing to listen. The Bible says, and he taught daily in the temple, and the Bible says not only did he teach in the temple, but in verse 48, for all the people were very attentive to hear him. They wanted to hear what he had to say. And, you know, can I say this? That's something where we've got to cultivate our spirits. I want to hear what God's word says. I want to consider this. I remember one time going to a funeral. And forgive me for being this way, but I'm just human. And the minister got up there very monotone. I'm like, this is going to be boring. And he was dry and dusty and monotone. But I'll tell you what, as he began to read the Word of God, everything changed, because I stopped looking at him and started looking at the Word of God that he was reading, and God began to speak to my heart. It wasn't the minister that was the issue. It was the Word that he was preaching. I'll be honest, he started teaching one way, but the Holy Spirit of God started showing me some other things, as I'm wont to do, amen. And I started taking notes at a funeral. So you're taking notes at a funeral. When God talks, I want to take notes. I want to capture what he's saying. When I read my Bible, I've got a pen in hand. I've got a tablet beside me oftentimes, or I've got a wide margin Bible so I can write those notes down there. When I was at the conference 2 weeks ago, I had my notebook there, and I was writing notes. So why? Because I don't want to lose those things that God gave to me. There's been times, and Mrs. Ross can tell you this, there'll be times in the middle of the night I'll just jump out of bed and turn my phone on and shine it on a 3x5 card and write down some notes and turn it off and jump back into bed. Why? I don't want to miss when God's speaking to me. This might sound a little strange. There have been times when I've been in the shower. When God's put a thought on my heart, I've turned off the shower, put a towel around me, wrote it down, and got back in. You say, Pastor, you're nuts. Yes, I am, but I don't want to lose what he gave me, because there's been too many times when God's spoken that I haven't taken that time to write it down, and I've lost it. And I'll tell you what, there's nothing more frustrating than losing a truth or a principle that could have helped that's gone, and it's gone. You said you beg God for back. I beg God for back, but sometimes God's saying, hey, I try to get your attention, and I need to take priority here. So we see the proper use of the temple, the daily teaching, but also the attentive listening. As we finish up tonight, I want to say this. Perhaps Jerusalem would have been better prepared for the days ahead had the temple been kept in proper use. And I want to say there's a direct parallel to us, isn't there? Perhaps we'd be better prepared for the days ahead if we gave the things of God, and part of that is the ministry that we're involved in and the church that we're members of, the body that we're joined to, if we keep that in good working order as well. I really believe this, that we see the temple's problems and the running of the temple. We see the problems with that back when Jesus Christ's birth was announced, when the wise men came in and asked, where is he that's born King of the Jews? Had the temple been what it should have been, a house of prayer, they too would have been looking for the birth of the Messiah, because they would have been prompted by Scripture to be looking for his signs in the heavens, just like the wise men were. It's a shame that Gentiles knew about the birth of the Jewish Messiah before any of his own people were waiting for that. And not only that, when they were sought for by Herod, they did not bother to go down and check out Bethlehem like the wise men did. That tells me the temple had some problems that Jesus Christ attempted to correct, but guess what? They failed the people. And can I say the people should have demanded more from them than what they were getting as well. We have a special privilege. We have a wonderful Savior. Great things happen on this day, the praise and the adoration. We thank God for that. But I also say, let's not miss the zeal that Jesus Christ had for the temple as he turned the place upside down and tried to set things right in that temple, and see how he taught daily in that temple the things that the people needed to hear, and how the people received him and were very attentive to him. We have a special thing. We have a church. We have a family here. And may we do our part by being present. Like I said, it's hard to preach to empty chairs, but they don't really respond very well. They don't ever come forward at the invitation. They never sing out during the songs of praise. But when people are in them and people have hearts that are prepared and ears that are open, great things can happen. Great truths can be disseminated and lives can be changed. Let's make sure that our temple, this church house, this place where we gather together as God's children, is always kept in proper use. And we just appreciate more and more what our Savior's done for us. A very interesting week that we have before us, starting with Palm Sunday and just all the things that happened to Jesus Christ leading up to the crucifixion, and then certainly the joyous celebration of his resurrection in a week's time. It's an incredible week. I hope that this week, as we depart from here tonight and go to our separate homes, that we'll consider what Jesus Christ was going through during his earthly life during this week of time. He knew the cross was ahead. He knew it was just a few days. Can you imagine what was going through his mind and his heart? And I see it here as he's teaching in this temple, these last truths that he can get out before he's crucified, how important those words must have been. I almost wish that the Holy Spirit would have allowed some of the sermons that he taught in those last days to be recorded for us so we could see the urgency and the passion behind his words there. And wouldn't you like to be one of those people to get to hear him preach in the temple that day as he taught great things? We have a great Savior and a phenomenal book to learn from. May we take it to heart and may we hold it dear and regard it dear as servants of God and children of Christ, children of God and servants of Christ.